Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Welcome everyone to our October 5th meeting in Alamance County Commissioners. Please join me in the invocation. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for the many blessings you've bestowed on each one of us. And Lord, as we come to you now, Father, I just lift up the families of the victims of the shooting in Oregon. Lord, I just pray that you'd give them peace and comfort, Lord, during this time of sorrow. Father, I do pray for the crew of the missing ship out at sea that was caught in the hurricane. Lord, we pray, Lord, they haven't been found. Lord, we just pray for their safety. And Lord, again, we thank you for the many blessings. Lord, I just pray that you'll guide and direct this board as they conduct the business of the people. And these things I do pray in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand for our pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Public speakers, we have two that have signed up to speak. Mr. Tony Cox.
With the guns, take everybody's. Period. Take everybody's gun. Don't nobody need a gun. If you put yourself in a situation where you need a gun, you use your fist. Period. Don't need a gun. 287G saga continues. Man, they gonna do whatever it takes to protect their law. I've compared it to the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance many times. I see them as side by side. And what I see is the law in itself, Constitution, the law in itself was discriminatory when it was done. The Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance, according to Ben Pierce, the county, Assistant County Attorney, had many inherent problems. But if you go back to 287G and look at the meetings and stuff, just like the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance, you're going to find issues with the law. In Alamance County, I went after the law. The law was rescinded with the admission of wrongdoing in the adoption and enforcement of the law. 287G, same thing. People that are targeted, they don't get any repercussions from these laws, rules, and policies. But the little people, they get jumped on, misused, and abused by these laws, rules, and policies. The Constitution is the way to bring this country back, period. As a small business owner, if I growed up and became big, why would I come to the government and say, give me some money? It's a tax deduction. But hey, when you got power and influence, it is what it is. I remember in the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance, the law firm told me that there is nothing wrong with what's going on, when it was right around the time that it was being said that the law had many inherent problems, constitutional rights violations. I would like to finish up this right here with the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance, because my First Amendment says redress my government. Redress, redress, redress. If it was over there in the courts, I could go through the courts with no problem. All I need is a lawyer to show me the way, do the documents. But hey, who cares until it becomes them? The DOJ, they worried about 287G, and we got from the newspaper over here people that have been in jail since 2011. Constitutional rights.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. Appreciate it. Next, we have Ms. Ann Kassebaum. Welcome.
Thank you.
Commissioners, news reports of closed meetings to buy 111 acres of the Guilford County Farm to give or sell to a European industry bring me here to ask you to slow down and consider alternatives for this industry and these jobs that would cost Alamance taxpayers far less. Certainly, jobs are important, but why this land? It is far from the interstate. It is publicly owned by the people of Guilford County, and it's in an area that's agricultural and increasingly residential. Why not private land? There's plenty of that with water and sewer already, right by the interstate in areas that are commercial. The whole deal seems odd. Why was the European industry directed to this site, where taxpayers will have to pay for new roads, new water and sewer lines, plus all other incentives? Is this one step in another unlikely plan to develop an industrial park there? The loss of these public lands would be an even higher cost. An area as large and unspoiled as the Guilford County Farm is rare. Last June, these 700 acres were given over to the management of Guilford Parks and Recreation, which seeks to develop sustainable agriculture there that would feed us and keep wealth local. They have plans under development for walking trails. These trails would serve two areas of our county that are expanding in that direction, Gibsonville and Elon, and they would be eliminated by this proposed purchase. Just last week, hundreds of people were able to pick 4,000 pounds or more of free grapes there in an event sponsored by the North Carolina Wildlife Habitat Foundation that seeks to have a larger role there in the future. Those who came out commented on the beauty of the farm, even in drizzling rain. I urge you to let the people of Alamance have more information before you proceed, and for you to come out and see the county farm for yourself. It is a treasure on our Guilford-Alamance border that benefits both counties and that should be held in trust for those who come after us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kasbaum. All right, Commissioner's responses to proposed speakers.
Well, I'd like to say that I talked with Ms. Kasbaum, and she invited me to come walk the property, and I said that I would do that, and I would be very happy to come, and I'm sure you'd like to have any of us join me, right? If anybody would like to join me, we don't have a date set yet, but.
There's a lot of history in the county farm. As a matter of fact, my great uncle Lee Engle was the in charge of the county farm at one time as a prison official. He was Captain Lee, they called him, and many years ago. And it's some of the richest farmland in Alamance County, particularly in the northwestern part of the county. I know back when they were looking at Haystack, Roger Haystack, Commissioner Steve Troxler came out against Project Haystack. So it's something that this board needs to take a good hard look at as we come down the road at all the different aspects, Ms. Kasbaum, and we will do so.
Thank you.
Any further comments?
Have we had a closed session on this that I missed?
Yes and no, Judge. You were there. It was just briefly just a...
We didn't have a closed meeting.
Informational. No, we didn't have a closed meeting. It was more or less just a potential economic incentive coming down the road. So.
Well, I know the farm real well. Howard Cole and I used to go out there for lunch about every other week because we'd run out of money.
You probably remember Captain Lee.
Yeah, he was Captain Lee. Absolutely.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Judge. Any further comments? All right, the agendas. Do I have a motion approval of the agenda for today?
Motion to approve.
No,
second.
Motion second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. The consent agenda. Members, any items to be pulled from the consent agenda for discussion?
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Motion is second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Moving on to item number seven, public hearing. Members, do I have a motion that we go into public hearing for the approval of economic development incentives for Meredith Webb Printing Company?
Make a motion. Go into.
Second.
Motion is second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We're now in public hearing, and Ms. Honeycutt, do you want to speak?
I'd be glad to. As the board's aware, at our last meeting, we set the public hearing today for the incentive request for Meredith Webb. What they're looking for, very simply, is incentives based upon $10 million worth of new taxable capital investment and 10 new full-time equivalent jobs. So that would be paid over a five-year period. So we would look at $150,000 to be paid over that five-year period based upon the $10 million in total investment.
Thank you, sir. We have several representatives here from Meredith Webb. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Hagan. Commissioners, I'm Lawson Brown, practice law with the Vernon Law Firm. I also work at the City of Mebane. It is my pleasure to be representing Meredith Webb on this particular request. A Burlington, North Carolina company since 1952. They've made over $20 million worth of investments in the last 5 to 10 years and have not sought any incentives. This is a $10 million printing press that they were looking at putting in Greenville, South Carolina, or in Burlington, North Carolina. This and the City of Burlington incentives, I think, will indicate that they will be putting that investment in their plant in Burlington. Travers Webb, founder, son, and president of the company, is here if you have any questions that I can't answer, but I'm just real excited. I can't remember an existing industry other than Kaiser Roth that's been before any of the public boards to ask for assistance. In terms of the economics of this, y'all have looked at the pie charts and the graphs on what an investment of this size will do to the tax base and to the tax revenue. And we thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Thank you, sir. Any of the company folks like to speak? Yes,
sir. I'm Travers Webb. Any questions about what we're trying to do?
None from the board, sir. Thank you, Mr. Webb. We appreciate it.
Sir.
Well, this is a public hearing, ladies and gentlemen. Do I have anyone from this side that would like to speak on this economic incentive issue today from the public, any members of the public? Seeing none, I will move to this side. Anyone on this side like to speak today?
Mr. Carter. First, I applaud y'all.
Good job. I would think everybody would, but hey. I would say look at the floods in South Carolina, and that would give you a good decision. Stay here.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. Anyone else from this side? All right, hearing none, I will entertain a motion this time. Do I have a motion that we approve the economic development incentive? I'm sorry. Thank you, Mr. Vice Chair Boswell. Do I have a motion that we close the public hearing at this time?
So move.
Second.
Motion is second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
Mr. Chairman, also there is a revised incentive agreement in front of you. I think Commissioner Byrd had some questions, some minor changes, just some clarifications, and also from their attorney. So the one in front of you, the paper copy, is the one that you would be approving. But again, the revisions were just more clarifications than they were.
That's right. Nothing substantive. I just saw a couple of things. I wanted to make sure it was worded correctly. Mr. Chairman, if I could say, just to make sure that we all understand the nature of this agreement. So Meredith Webb would be adding $10 million worth of taxable assets. And that, at our current tax rate of 58 cents, would mean we would be receiving $58,000 per year in tax revenue.
Yes,
is that right? And then our obligation back to them after they've made the investment and after they've hired the 10 additional employees, yes, that we're going to be paying them over a five-year period, $30,000
yes,
per year. So we're going to be netting $28,000 per year in cash flow, plus the jobs associated with this arrangement.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Brewer.
Just wanted to make sure that that was right.
Ms. Albright, any other changes in the contract?
Just a few minor ones that Mr. Brown suggested by email, we made them.
Nothing in terms of dollar figures?
No, sir.
All right, with that being said, I will ask for a, do I have a motion that we, for approval of the economic development incentive as amended?
Go ahead.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Motion second, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And thank y'all for considering Burlington to stay in. As Tony said, we need to applaud our companies.
Yes, sir, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have some more things to come, and so we'll be back to see you again in a few more months.
You've been good neighbors, sir, and we appreciate it.
Yeah.
I was not joking in my applause.
I agree.
Thank you, sir, thank you, Ms. Cummings. Next, we have the 2015 National Long-Term Care Residents Right Month Proclamation. Ms. Foxenhofer, and I'm going to join you at the podium, ma'am. You go ahead and speak as I'm coming down.
I'm a member of the Alamance County Community Advisory Committee, which is appointed by you, thank you. And we work with and under, as volunteers, under the Ombudsman Program with the Area Agency on Aging. And as such, we visit our licensed homes in the county. I personally visit about 15 of our adult care and family care homes, and other team members visit nursing homes and additional homes. There are over 40 adult care and family care homes in the county, and that's quite a lot to cover. The declaration that I'm, or proclamation that I'm going to read is one that was made by Governor McCrory. State of North Carolina, Pat McCrory, Governor. Long-Term Care Residents' Rights Month 2015, by the Governor of the State of North Carolina, a proclamation. Whereas the Federal Nursing Home Reform Act of 1987 guarantees residents their individual rights in order to promote and maintain their dignity, autonomy, and individuality. And whereas the North Carolina General Assembly enacted legislation to protect the rights of residents in nursing homes through the Patient's Bill of Rights, and those in adult care homes through the Resident's Bill of Rights. And whereas the Long-Term Care Ombudsman Program was created under the Federal Older Americans Act and by the General Assembly to ensure residents in facilities are afforded the same considerations and opportunities to exercise their basic freedoms that individuals in the community take for granted. And whereas, while a concerned individual can be an effective advocate for a single resident, the work of more than 1,000 volunteer community advisory committee members who are appointed by local boards of county commissioners is making a significant difference for residents statewide. And whereas there are approximately 50,000 individuals living in nursing homes and 40,000 individuals living in adult care facilities in North Carolina, residents should be informed of their rights so they may be empowered to live with dignity and self-determination. And whereas individuals, groups, and long-term care facilities across the country will be celebrating Resident Rights Month with the theme Care Matters, to emphasize the importance of affirming these rights through facility practices, public policy, and resident-centered decision-making. Now, therefore, I, Pat McCrory, Governor of the State of North Carolina, do hereby proclaim October 2015 as Long-Term Care Residents' Rights Month in North Carolina and commend its observance to all its citizens. I would like to request on behalf of the Alamance County Community Advisory Committee that our county commissioners declare that this is Long-Term Care Resident Rights Month in the County of Alamance. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So by consensus from this board, we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim October 15th as National Long-Term Care Residents' Rights Month in Alamance County, and we encourage all citizens to join in these important services in this fifth day of October 2015. Thank you, ma'am. We appreciate the job you're doing. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, may I say one thing?
Yes, sir.
I served on the Community Advisory Committee for adult care homes for several years early in my career here, and I appreciate all the work that you do. It's very important work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Burke. Next, we have discussion of Burlington Transportation Alamance Community College route. County Manager Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As the board's aware, we have had presentations from the city of Burlington, and Mike Young was here about a month ago talking about what they plan to do with respect to their fixed route system. There was discussion about a quote-unquote fifth route that would be from West Burlington to Graham to the community college, and what we could do. And there's been discussion with a lot of partners willing to help fund that, and I think a lot of those partners are here today, and we wanted to bring this back to the board to see if there was interest from our board to be a partner on this fifth route as well. So with that said,
Thank you, Mr. Honeycutt. I'd like to call on Mr. Harold Owen if he'd like to say a few words in reference to this. Harold would have been here at our meeting when we had this discussion and presentation, but he had a death in the family, and we send our condolences to you, sir.
Thank you.
It's welcome. I know you've retired now, but I think you're busier now than you were as a city manager. I see you all over the place.
Well, my wife has made sure that's an exact question answer there, I assure you. Not to make light of this, but we started transportation when I had dark hair, these conversations. And literally it's been going on for nearly a decade. And it's taken many different routes, not using a pun here, but where we are here today is the system is in place. We've had conversations with a number of people concerning the need to, well, we're talking about economic development, and we just mentioned, you said Mr. Webb in front of us a few minutes ago. Travis talked to us in Burlington about a month and a half ago about his issues and what he's doing and what he's hiring. And so many of the people that we see in all of our industry we're bringing in our community now are individuals that, quite frankly, are trained at a community college level. Community college is enormously important to the future of this county. So as we talked, and Algie and I have talked numerous times about this, is what would be a plausible way of getting a fifth route where we'd have more of a direct route to get potential students to ACC. And I think we've come up with one. The concept would be really the hub there is in downtown Burlington, and would be a route that would come out directly from there, come down either Webb Avenue or whatever, come to into Graham. We've talked to Mr. Honeycutt about a possible stop here in terms of getting people here to help pay taxes, whatever else to use any county services. We've had conversations. Continue to have conversations with the city of Graham. We're actually going to talk to them tomorrow night and see where they are on all this. But the community college, and I'll certainly let Mr. Algie about to speak to their commitment, but we've got obviously a commitment from United Way. Patrick Harmon is here today. This is kind of awkward. Patrick, you might want to speak briefly, if you could, on what your... I received a letter last week from Patrick on a potential commitment from your group. And Patrick, you may want to...
Sure.
That's okay.
Yes, sir. That's fine, Harold. I think you've been a city manager, I believe.
I have. You learned to put all these bullfrogs in one wheelbarrow.
Welcome, Mr. Walker.
Good morning, Commissioners. Nice to see you all again. It's been a while since I've been over here. As most of you know, I've been a big supporter of public transit. I had hair when we started. Harold, I had gray hair.
I wish you two quit talking.
Well, I know. You have to just accept it at some point. And then shave it off. That's what I did. But we've been a big proponent of having a fixed route public transit system in Alamance County for quite a while now, and are really happy to financially support this ACC route because, like Harold was saying, it's critical to meet the needs in the community. And so we're doing $10,000 a year each year for 4 years to support this potential route out to the community college, and probably support it after that as well. So hopefully you guys can support it as well because it's really a needed service for the county. So thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Gatewood, would you like to say a few words, sir?
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, first let me say thank you for allowing me to say a few words. I really do appreciate it. You are an exceptional board of commissioners. It is clear that you support your community college, just as you support a lot of other things here in this county. And I truly believe that your support to the community college is based on a deep appreciation of the role of that the college plays in developing, helping people to develop job skills, workforce development, and preparing the workforce for a competitive 21st century. You have demonstrated a commitment to jobs and to economic development, and I think that was made very clear when you decided to fund the $15 million Advanced Applied Technology Center, which we plan to have completed in August of 17. But as indicated earlier, my purpose today is just to share some thoughts on what the bus system linking Burlington to Alamance Community College could do for students and for this county. One of the major barriers of students face when in terms of getting to ACC is transportation. And we do surveys every year to find out why some students drop out. And without fail, transportation reigns near the top. It goes along with finances and child care and other things. And it's not just a survey. I see this daily in walking through the campus. In fact, on last Monday, I believe it was, I stopped by a student commons area and just chatted with some of the students there. Now, first they were astounded that the president would talk to them. I don't know why. But we got to talking, and I said, well, what time is your next class? This must have been around 1 o'clock. He said, we're finished for today. And I said, well, why are you still here? Waiting for our rides. So students, it's not only about getting to the campus, it's also about leaving the campus. Some students can get there, others cannot. And even those who can get there can't seem to get away. And, you know, it bothers me because I'm saying to myself that, you know, some of the students could have part-time jobs to help them pay for their college expenses, and others could probably help their families in other ways. But it is what it is. And we know that transportation, having some way to connect with Burlington, where most of our population reside, would be a good thing in terms of removing some of these barriers. Let me give you another thought. Community colleges all across this nation were built on the open door concept. Well, what that really means is if you can get to our doors, then we'll work with you no matter where you are. I was having a conversation earlier this morning with a gentleman about GED opportunities. If you can get to our doors, we're going to make those opportunities work. But that open door is more like a closed door. It may as well have chains and locks on it for people who can't reach the door. So it's all about getting to that door. Now, there is a clear link between educational attainment, earnings, and training. In fact, research shows that the difference between someone with a college education and when someone without a college education, in terms of dollars over a lifetime, is roughly $1 million. So that's $1 million worth of revenue that, first, the person or student is not earning. Second, the county is not benefiting from the taxes that would come from that $1 million. And you multiply that times all the students or all the people who could be students getting an education, and those that are not, and that's a tremendous loss. So what that boils down to is that the more people we can provide education and training to, and the more people who become skilled to enjoy better jobs, make money, and pay into the tax base, equates to a deeper appreciation of education and gainful employment and the link to the stronger tax base. Now, it sounds like I said that twice, and maybe I did, but it's a key point. It all works together. Now, it doesn't stop here. Last week, I specifically went over to East Burlington and visited with some people there, people that I'd never met before, and they'd never met me either. One person did recognize me, said, "I seen me in the newspaper." But my simple question to them was, what would a bus system do for you? And without fail, each of the people that was asked that question responded essentially the same. And to paraphrase, it was God, it would be God sent. I visited the Positive Attitude Youth Center. They said the same. The Charles Drew Community Health Center, they said the same. And the Mega Walmart, that's where you really find
that's
a lot of people.
Find the real answer.
Yeah, and the answers were the same from those people there. But there's one thing they mentioned to me that I hadn't even given consideration to, and that was that the Charles Drew Community Health Center. They said, well, you know, it would also provide an opportunity not only for students to get to college, but for students at your college to come here and get health care services. We don't have an infirmary on the campus, so that's just a residual benefit that could be possible if this were to take place. So let me close by saying mass transportation connecting people with colleges is, unfortunately, it's not new. But we do know that it does work. And I want to take this opportunity to thank the City of Burlington for their willingness to make an investment. I want to thank the United Way, and some of those leaders are here today. Thank you so much, United Way, for your willing to invest in the future of our students, in the future of our residents, and in the tax base of this county. The representative from the Haman Harmon Foundation, thank you, sir. And lastly, I want to recognize the chairman of our Board of Trustees, Chairman Jerry Bailey, and thank you for your support, Trustee Bailey. And then I should conclude this time for real by saying that the college will participate in this pursuant to the full board's approval. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. I'd like to also welcome our good friends from the great City Council that are here today, and welcome. I know that you're considering also possibly participating in this, and so thank you for being here today. And Mayor, thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman, let me, if I could, recognize Mayor Lenny Williams from Gibsonville, who's here, and they are part of the
Thank you, Mayor, for being here.
And Ben Baxter, their city manager. Basically, what you got here today is the possibility of multiple jurisdictions working together to make something work. It would be the City of Burlington, it would be Alamance County, it would be ACC, it would be United Way, and now with the Hayden-Harmon possibilities now. What Graham does, certainly that's their decision tomorrow night, but this is what would take a route. Now, the route itself is, it's just to make it very clear, all routes are based on a 45-minute headway back and forth. The routes would come from all over the town, would come to the middle focus there, downtown Burlington, and that's what this route and would these buses would feed to that and feed directly down the road into this area. Also, we have proposed to take this route as it goes through Graham down to the park and ride lot south of Graham, because a number of people do use that in terms of getting medical support and medical help at Duke and Chapel Hill. Proposed annual operational cost, this is operational, is $120,000. So it would be broken up amongst multiple jurisdictions if this is something that you guys would consider.
Thank you, Ms. Sullivan. We appreciate it. Discussion from commissioners.
Well, number one, I like to have Mike come back up and just reiterate, if we don't do this, how does somebody get to ACC? I think that's a vital link to this decision.
Yes, sir. Good question. Currently, thank you. Thank you for your time also. Currently, we have four routes. If you were wanting to go to ACC, Community College, you would have to take that route wherever you are to downtown Burlington and then get on the red route, which goes out to the medical center, ARMC. They're going to have a park and ride lot. And then once you get there, you would have to get off that bus, the fixed route bus, and get onto the PART system, the Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation. And they would go out to ACC, which they currently are right now. The key with that is they only go roughly twice in the morning and twice in the evening. So you would still have people waiting and scheduling different classes and things like that on a 2 a.m. and 2 p.m. trip. What this would do, this route would provide about every 45 minutes from 5:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. So you get the benefit of frequency with the fifth route. And you also, the passenger doesn't have to get off of our fixed route system and go to actually another regional system. So that's a very good question. Yeah. So without the fifth route, you're working with another system, minimal times to the college.
Well, and the reason I ask that, because I think that's very important. I just cannot visualize people spending all their day riding buses all the way around town when you have a possibility of a direct route.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Well, Mr. Burke, I'd like to make some comments in support of participating in this. I've been on lots of different boards through the years and have been involved with a lot of different agencies and been involved with a number of community needs assessments, and every one, it comes back, one of the biggest needs is a fixed route transportation system. And I think it's important, this adding this fifth route, from just everything that Dr. Gatewood said and the economic development impact of it. And you know, this public transportation system has regional implications as well. So I serve on the PART board, and where PART stops for the other cities that they stop at, people, when people go to those communities, once they get off the PART bus, then there's an option for them to get elsewhere in that community. If you can't get to the final destination, the regional transportation system kind of falls apart as well. So we're going to have the fixed route system thanks to Burlington and Gibsonville and what they've done so far. But the more spread out that we can make this, the better it's going to work for people that want to come to Burlington from other places on the PART bus, and then they can get off at, say, at ACC, do business at ACC, go to some classes, and then they can get elsewhere, like to Charles Drew, or go shopping or do other things as well. So, I mean, it's just, it all has to work together. And I love this proposal because of the collaboration that's being presented to us between the private sector and the public sector. And I think it would be wonderful if Graham would participate as well.
Any further discussion?
We have a transportation system that we support every year now, and I don't see them involved in this issue at all. And I cannot, in all good conscience, in serving the people, take on another transportation system when we already have one, the county does. And I have always been a strong supporter of ACC. I spent 8 years on their board of trustees. I've supported them ever since, and even and certainly before that, and shall continue to support them. City Manager Harold Owens is a good friend, and I'm proud of the work and the career he had, but again, I can't do it. I'm sorry.
Could I speak to that, Commissioner Smith? Could I serve on the active board, too, representing this board? And that the Alamance County Transportation Authority is a little bit different kind of a transportation service. I mean, it's a response demand kind of service. It's more like a sort of a taxi with the ability to take care of handicapped people, and it's expensive. I mean, just by the nature of that particular thing. It's not a fixed route, but ACTA hopefully will be providing the required paratransit service that a fixed route system needs to have. Mike, I can't remember the exact details. It's like within a half a mile or a quarter mile.
Three quarters of a mile
of each side of each route, so that if a disabled person who really can't get to the bus stop needs transportation, then a paratransit company such as ACTA would be providing that service. So we haven't formalized that relationship yet, but hopefully that'll work out. ACTA will be able to provide that service along with the fixed route system and your system will.
Question for Mr. Honeycutt.
Yes, sir.
One of the problems that we ran into in terms of grants, I think it was, with ACTA and going into these municipalities was there was a problem with that. Can you explain what happened with that?
They had the Rural Operating and Assistance Program, I think that's in
rope.
The past, the rope program. In the past, we got audited and we were running some internal to municipalities, mm-hmm. and that was not considered quote unquote rural.
Yeah.
So we had to help subsidize ACTA, I think it was about $60,000 to make up for that cost. So they cannot operate within inside the municipal limits or where there will be a fixed route anymore.
Right.
So.
And isn't ACTA, I mean, you have to call a date ahead to arrange that ride, and I can't see college folks sometimes.
It has to be scheduled, right?
And Mr. Chairman, just to clarify as well, and I want to make sure our figures is right, if you do vote to do this, it is a commitment of $25,000, is what I believe is being requested from the county to participate.
That's per year.
Yes. Yes, sir, moving forward. And again, that then it will become a budgetary item each year.
I think we have a question, Mr. Kimmer. Yes, you may. Yes.
There was no details in the agenda in regards to this issue.
Yes.
This commitment, $25,000, is just a one-time annual commitment. Is there any agreement that this is going to be funded on an annual basis? Just a one-time $25,000 commitment. Is that correct?
The motion that I'm going to make, Mr. Cameron, unless it's amended by the board and they have a right to do that, is that we reevaluate in 1 year. This is a one-time commitment. We reevaluate a year from now.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And so you've heard my motion. I make a motion that we allocate $25,000 towards this endeavor, also that we come back in 1 year and we reevaluate. We hear a presentation on how well it's doing, and we determine at that time whether we will continue the program or not.
I would like to amend that just a little
bit. Sir.
I think maybe we need to look at this during our budget cycle as opposed to next October, as to look and see where we are with it come.
And that's why, so we'll look at it in the early part of next year.
Okay.
To determine.
If the board's agreeable, what we will do is we will add this as a line item to our budget moving forward, but it will be part of the discussion during that time.
During the budget.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So the motion is on the floor. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
The motion is second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Right. Now, we're not going to have very much data for at this next budget cycle.
Right.
Because the system's not going to be running until when?
Early summer. June, hopefully.
So it's going to be kind of hard.
You can come back and give us an update where you're
sure.
Right.
In that process.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Thank you. All right, moving on to the next item on the agenda, new mentoring program, dispute settlement and youth services, Pamela Thompson and Christy Andrews.
I don't see Pam here.
I don't see Pam either. Christy's on the way.
Yes,
yeah, Christy's on the way. Yeah,
Christy's coming up.
Well, first of all, I just want to say thank you. Probably had to admit I was a little shorter than everybody else. Thank you for allowing me to speak here today and have your time today. I also want to thank you all for the huge support that you give our agency at Dispute Settlement Youth Services. We couldn't operate as we do without you. My purpose here today is to more so just to make you aware of our new program started July 1st, 2015. It is a mentoring program that prioritizes youth that are involved in juvenile justice. This community has not had this program in quite some time and has screamed, yelled, shouted that they want it and need it. So I'm very happy I have the privilege to manage this program from scratch, and I have modeled it after an evidence-based model similar to Big Brothers and Big Sisters. And I've tweaked it a little bit just because I know what works with the juvenile justice population, and added a team approach where we can have, so it operates much like a traditional mentoring program with adult mentors, a youth, ages from 7 to 17, again, that prioritize the kids involved with juvenile justice. And they do activities together, development activities. They're going to participate in educational seminars and things like that. They're also going to do community service to give back to our community as well. And then in addition to that, that team approach I was speaking of is where we engage all the systems that are involved. So it'll be juvenile justice court counselors. It'll be the school social workers, most likely, or a representative from the school. It will also be other, whether it be church, whether it be other community stakeholders involved. It will all come together to support this match. A mentor and a mentee will support this match in developing a plan that put in place to work towards some goal, that the individualized goal. We have at that table, we'll have the resources, and we'll have, you know, the folks that know and can network and can connect us to make that goal achievable. What I'm doing now is I've went through my first round of training, so I have 11 mentors that are ready to go and that are very excited, and I've just was hugely impressed about all of the community, some people that had really stepped up to the plate. So I was very excited to have again another privilege and opportunity to work with some of these folks. I don't know if it's Heidi's husband. Heidi's husband, Howie Norick, is one of our volunteers. Steve Fischel, which was a chief court counselor here a few years back in our district. He's one, and again, we have many others. But right now, what I'm doing is rallying the community and getting support and trying to talk to other business and so see how they can invest and partner with the agency as well, with activities, with, you know, food sponsorships and things like that. So again, I was just here today just to make you aware and let you know what's going on across the street. I have a few things. Can I leave that for you?
Yes, you may.
Okay. And I'll just set it on this table, or?
Yeah, you can.
I can get it.
We can, yeah, okay. We'll pass them out. Right. Thank you, Kristen.
Thank you. Uh-huh. And then if there's
any questions or comments?
I think it's exciting what you're doing and being on the JCPC.
Yes.
I know we've talked about this, and I'd like to welcome John Cox, who is over the JCPC now in his new role. So, and where is your center located?
We are literally across the street. We're at 201 West Elm Street,
okay.
So right across from the courts and the jail.
The court services building.
Yes, the court services building. But the veterans now are, and a few other state commission.
Okay. Christy, we thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Have a wonderful day.
Appreciate it. All right, next we have the proposed changes to the county health insurance plan. County Manager Honeycutt and Donna Dixon.
I'm going to have Sherry introduce Donna.
Hello. Sure. I'm not Craig Honeycutt.
No.
Okay, commissioners. The insurance committee met a couple on September 25th to discuss potential changes to the health insurance and prescription insurance plans, and these are based on recommendations from our new broker, Pierce Group. I've got Donna Nixon is here, and she's going to address the board, but some of the things that we're going to talk about is changing our pharmacy benefits manager from ProCare RX to Optum RX. We've had some issues with ProCare over the past year. Some of these have been in customer service. Some of these have been costly to the county. So we feel that it's time to make a change there. And then Pierce Group is also recommending some changes to our insurance plan that would include some increased deductibles, increased coinsurance, and then a 5% increase to employee premiums to the plan. This is not going to be for employees. They would still receive their insurance at no cost. It would be an increase in the amount that the county contributes on their behalf into the insurance plan, but we would also have an increase in the charge for employees that choose to put a dependent or spouse on the plan. So I'm going to have Donna come up and talk, and it looks like it. Yeah, just Donna.
Great. Thank you, Sherry.
Welcome, Donna.
Good morning, commissioners. Thank you so much for having me. Sherry mentioned, we have been very busy analyzing the health insurance and all of the components of your benefit package with the mind that we want to try to find as much cost savings and improved services as possible. Our recommendation, as Sherry mentioned, is to change the pharmacy benefit manager from ProCare Rx to Optum Rx effective January 1st of 2015. We would be undergoing a huge education campaign with the employees during open enrollment to ensure that they understand the value of the new plan, how it works, and how to render services. We're also recommending to make some small changes to the current health plan design with a goal to maintain the grandfathered status, which is something that has been a priority with the ACA legislation upon us. And that is also going to help increase the fund balance and get the contribution rates closer to market rates. That is a 5% increase there, very minimal change to the employees that have dependent covered. I think I included a contribution table there for you as well. The main reason and what excites me the most about the change to the pharmacy benefit manager is, although we are recommending a large PBM, they have the expertise and the experience to provide the level of service that Alamance County deserves. They have a specialized government segment that will actually look after the account, and it will include clinical programs, which is going to start to lower those health care costs going forward.
I had one question. I thought I read that the only thing that's going to be changing as far as clinical management is the diabetes part, and then all these other clinical conditions will be added.
Right. So there's going to
actually. How's the diabetes being handled now?
So right now, members can enroll in a diabetes program in which the county then waives their cost share for those prescriptions. The intention was to hope that they would have some case management associated with that program as well. However, ProCare has not been able to honor that side of the commitment. So there's really no medical management or case management actually going on right now. People are just getting their prescriptions covered at 100% for those with diabetes. Now, you have about 1,400 members covered on the plan today. 56 of those are reaping that benefit. What we'd like to do is really look at all disease states, and I think in your packet you saw that we are going to include 10 different disease states. Several of those disease states are actually much higher in population for your membership than diabetes, and all of those would be part of that medical management program. Where they would get counseling from licensed nurses and pharmacists to help them manage their conditions. There's also an outreach component directly to their physicians to try to appropriate their care.
This is all through the prescription program.
It is.
So for the regular health benefit, we're still self-insured, is that right?
That's correct.
And then we have the clinic at the hospital.
Right. Yes.
Is there any disease management associated with that relationship with the hospital?
There's clinic services available. There's not a strong disease management, no.
Okay. And, Mr. Chairman, if I could also mention, the increases that we're looking at as far as the premiums for family and also for spouse are very minimal. And, again, as Donna mentioned, we want to keep our grandfather status under the Affordable Health Care Act. But the other thing is, one of the things that will be recommended in our audit that is coming up is that we need to increase the fund balance for our health, insurance, our self-funded line item. So by increasing the deductible sum and also by increasing the rates, that will address those issues as well. And again, I think if you look at our cost, it's very reasonable. For our employees, and with all the changes to health care right now, this is very minimal compared to what a lot of companies are going through.
I sit on that committee and agree with the manager. I can't remember, when was the last time we raised anything on health insurance?
It's not been since I've been here.
It's been probably 10 years or more, and you know, the committee knew we were going to have to get to this point. And as the manager says, it is minimal. We hate to do it, but I move that we approve the recommendations.
I'll second it.
All right, we have a motion second. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Judge's recommendation, I'm gonna vote yes.
Yes, see what I'm saying, aye?
Aye.
None opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, a couple budget amendments. Stacy, I think you have one with the Health Department. Welcome.
Good morning.
So we have a budget amendment for the summer food service program. We were allocated $3,375 by the Division of Public Health. This allocation reimburses our local efforts to do food inspections during the summer. And the monies will be used for new inspection scientific supplies and training for specialists in food and safety, food safety.
All right. Any questions?
What's the current rate of getting around to the food establishments per
we
year?
Consistently have 100% every fiscal year.
So once a year?
Oh, you mean for each different, it depends on what type of establishment it is. Some are inspected only a couple times a year. Some are inspected every quarter. It depends on the complexity of each one.
So moved.
Judge, we have a motion and a second. No further discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, budget amendment JCPC. Mr. Cox, come on up, sir. Welcome.
Good morning.
Morning.
I come to you as the chair of the JCPC, thanks to you guys. And
we appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate all the support we get from the commissioners. Today, I'm pleased to announce that the Realize Your Potential Committee of the JCPC has received an $8,000 grant from Impact Alamance. And as the county commissioners oversee the JCPC, I think we need your approval to be the pass-through agency for this grant. I can tell you a little bit about the Realize Your Potential Committee. It's comprised of about 15 members. It originally came to be because some folks from the business community were frustrated that we had so many folks trying to attain employment who couldn't because they had a criminal record. So we thought as a crime prevention council that we ought to do something at started with elementary kids but up through high school to impress upon young people the difficulty that some bad decisions they would make early in life can have on them later on, and perhaps prevent some percentage of these kids from making the wrong choice. It's comprised of some folks from the business community, some names you might know, Phil Bowers, Audrey Marsh. We also have some folks from the school system. Todd Thorpe's a member of this, and the idea is that these videos will be available to kids online, but they'll also be used as part of a curriculum benefit in the school system. So the school will write a curriculum component to these videos. They'll be shown to kids within the school system, and then there'll be some, hopefully some learning that goes on from it. The purpose of the grant is to upgrade the software that they use to edit these videos and the actual video mechanisms, the cameras and things they use. Videos are for the most part done with kids who are part of the teen-to-teen theater, which Carol Plew heads up through the City of Burlington Parks and Rec. So our request, I think, is just that the board approve us receiving this money, and then as the chair of the JCPC, we'll be in charge of keeping track and making sure that it does what it's supposed to do.
So moved.
Thank you.
I'll second it. Sounds like a great program.
Right. Yeah, we have a motion and a second for acceptance of the grant from Impact Alamance to JCPC. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
John, maybe you can bring us a preview of one when you.
Yeah. Well, we can do it.
That would be great. I think it.
If you're inclined, they're available. If you go under the Realize Your Potential Alamance County site, there's a Facebook page for that committee, and the videos are available on that.
I think it's great.
Does that program have somebody like me?
Thank you, Mr. Cox. Thank you, Tony. Mr. Cox and Mr. Cox.
I'm sure.
Appreciate it. All right, county manager's report. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A couple things we do want to mention. We'll have Brian give you a quick update on the jail roof. that we've had some issues, especially with the torrential rain and leaking and moving of our guests.
Good morning, Commissioners. You know we're in the middle of replacing the roof at the jail, and last month the contractor believed they had reached a point where they could water test the roof and make sure it was not going to leak, and then they could cover it up. Obviously, they discovered some leaks during their water test, which were then compounded with all the rains that we've been having. We met with the contractor and the material supplier, Suprema, last Thursday, had an opportunity to have a meeting with folks from the jail, county attorney, myself, people from our facilities department, to talk with the contractor and find out what was the plan. Did they know where the leaks are coming from, which they do. Basically, they've indicated they need about a week of decent weather to be able to make the repairs that are needed. That has meant that we have had to relocate 29 prisoners at this time. We've had to relocate them from the jail. The leaks on the third floor necessitated that. And the contractor has indicated if they can get some good weather, get a break in the rain, they'll be able to make the repairs. They are over their time limit, so they're concerned about that. We are too. We'll be talking with them about the price and any damages we may have to negotiate with them. But and these costs that we're incurring due to the continued leak of the roof, we will pass on to the contractor. So they are on it at this time. They are working hard to solve it. I think the rain has caught them, pushed them beyond the original timeline. But we hope we'll be getting some sun here, maybe starting this afternoon. So I'll be happy to try to answer any questions that you may have.
Had we not went ahead when we did to start this roof repair, we already had open wounds and leaky roof in Brian.
Yes, sir, we did. And the board wisely decided to make the expensive repair that was needed rather than to patch it.
Right.
It's just unfortunate the contractor started running behind and then got caught in this rainstorm. So.
What about the damage from the leaking roof?
We are keeping up with those costs separately, and again, we will be passing those costs
charge back to the contractor.
We've notified all the insurance companies, and I'll be giving them a detailed list.
Yeah. But we're also keeping up with overtime at the jail, the cost of moving the prisoners. As Brian said, I think we've moved 29, so any overtime, any costs associated with that is being kept up with as well.
Any further questions?
All right. Thank you.
All right. A couple other things. One of the things I do want to thank is our emergency management department, and they opened up a temporary EOC with respect to all the rain that we've had, the potential flooding. And if you got a NICSL notification for emergency weather, let me do a quick commercial for that. Please sign up for text messages, for emails, for phone calls. It is a great tool that we use in Alamance County to notify our residents when there is problems, issues that they need to be made aware of. And with that being said, our Chief Fire Marshal and Emergency Management Director, Dave Leonard, will be retiring at the end of this month. Dave has decided to retire, and he is looking at working with the state of North Carolina. So he will retire from us and go work for the state. So we appreciate the work that Dave's done. We'll kind of formally recognize him at a later date. But Johnny Payne will be our interim fire marshal and emergency management director, and we'll begin advertising for that position. So we appreciate Johnny's willingness to step in as well. The other thing I do want to mention is, number one, baby boy Frank was born Saturday night at 3:08 in the morning. Seth Gavin Frank, mom and baby and dad are doing well. So Tori's timing, you know, her last day was Friday. So her timing couldn't have been any better. So just keep the friends and the new family and your thoughts. And with that being said, everybody knows Robin Smith, who is the paralegal in Clyde's office. Robin will be serving in the interim role as county clerk, and we appreciate Robin's willingness to stand up during this time. So Robin, thank you for all that you do. And also to remind you, our SOAR breakfast is this Thursday, October 8th at 8:30 a.m.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Honeycutt. Commissioners' comments. Judge, you got anything?
Move adjournment.
Let's go through the other commissioners first, then we'll take care of it.
If they had any comments, Mr. Chairman, you'd have heard it.
Thank you, Judge.
Saying right, Judge.
Bob?
No, I've said enough today.
Eddie?
No.
I'd just like to thank you for filling in for me the last meeting.
Sorry it was under those circumstances.
I'm hitting on about 6.5 out of 8 cylinders, so we're getting there. We feel a lot better than we were, and we are getting there. That's exciting about Tori and little Seth Gavin, certainly. That's part of my problem with my illness was I kept my grandson 6 months old and he gave me the daycare disease and trying to get over that. But I've talked enough, Judge. I'm going to shut up. So
thank you.
I have a motion that we adjourn.
He already got one, right?
Got one right there. Second. All right. Meeting's adjourned. How's that?
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.